Okay, it's working. Great. Thanks for your patience. And I always wanted to start a talk with a Terminator 2 theme, so I'm really happy to do that. So I will tell you something about IBM's AI journey. I will also tell you something about what the world is doing, and the universe, and the rest. And also what's happening now, what happened in the past, and what might happen in the future. And especially what we and you should do in order to prevent bad things from happening, okay? So this all started 2011 for IBM.
This was suspense beyond anything the world of chess had ever known. Garry Kasparov, 34 years old, a cheerful and confident player throughout a dominating career, hovered over his pieces in the deciding game of a match with an implacable challenger. Deep Blue.
Okay, 1997, sorry. This is a new slide. So that's the 2011 one.
From the T.J. Watson Research Center in Yorktown Heights, New York, this is Jeopardy, the IBM Challenge. In 2000, he became a five-time champion and went on to win three of Jeopardy's most prestigious tournaments, earning a record $3.2 million.
Ladies and gentlemen, Brad Rutter. And now our next player.
In 2004, his record-breaking 74-game win streak...
Ken.
Who is Aristophanes?
Ken.
What's the Trojan horse?
Ken.
Who is Jean Lafitte?
Ken.
What's the dodo?
Ken.
What is Stella?
It's just acne. You don't have this skin infection, also known as Hansen's disease. Watson.
What is leprosy?
You are right.
Attude brute for 1600.
Music fans wax rhapsodic about this Hungarian's transcendental etudes. Watson.
Who is Franz Liszt?
You are right.
Don't worry about it. For 1600.
You're just a little stiff. You don't have this painful mosquito-borne joint illness with a Swahili name. Watson?
What is dengue fever?
Okay, so and so and so and. Then 2014.
Now I'd like to show you a third capability which we've never shown before outside of our research labs. And this will give you a hint and a sense for where Watson is going in the future. The real question is, can a computer not just answer complex questions with simple answers, and not just take massive amounts of genomic data and come up with better treatments for cancer, but can a computer take raw information and digest and reason on that information and understand the context? So one of the prototype systems that we're building is something we call the debater. We give it freewheeling understanding of large bodies of information like Wikipedia, and we ask the computer, with no human intervention, construct arguments pro and con on any subject we throw at it. And the result of that is what I'd like to show in the demonstration now. If we could roll the video, please.
Hello, and welcome to the IBM Debating Technologies demonstration. Today we shall focus on detecting relevant claims. To proceed, please select a topic, and I will share with you my top predictions for pro claims and con claims.
So as I said, we could throw any subject at it. I've chosen some here, and let's just pick the first one. So it will now look for all the literature and try to understand, as a computer, what's a pro and what's a con for violent video games. Let's roll the first one.
Scanned approximately 4 million Wikipedia articles, returning 10 most relevant articles. Scanned all 3,000 sentences and top 10 articles. Detected sentences which contain candidate claims. Identified borders of candidate claims. Assessed pro and con polarity of candidate claims. Constructed demo speech with top claim predictions. Ready to deliver. You have selected the topic. The sale of violent video games to minors should be banned. I would like to raise the following points in support of the topic. Exposure to violent video games results in increased physiological arousal, aggression-related thoughts and feelings.
Okay, for sake of time, I cannot skip through the video because my laptop is there. I will skip that. Then also a short scene of this video here. That's 2018. Maybe you have seen that below as well.
I am your space companion.
Okay, so we are in space now. This happened June 2018. And then the rest of the ecosystem. So you see the AI hype really started around 2014-15 when the first neural networks have been outperforming human baseline here in the ImageNet competition. And yeah, since there we are in the AI race. So maybe you have seen this one where you can apply style transfer. This is a couple of years old already. And then maybe you have seen this one
here. So this is 10 times faster than the 20 seconds per image detector. And you can see that by the time it makes predictions, the entire state of the world has changed. And this wouldn't be very useful for an application. If we speed this up by another factor of 10, this is a detector running at 5 frames per second. This is a lot better, but for example, if there's any significant movement, I wouldn't want a system like this driving my car.
Okay. Who of you has seen YOLO before? Okay, so get ready. So get ready. Okay, then this is something cool. This is predicting 3D meshes from 2D video streams. I think Trump will like that. Together with something I show you later, you can do really powerful weapons. Then here the question, what do you think, what was first, the image or the caption? Okay, image, who thinks image? Hands up, please. Okay, so image was 2017, 2018, the caption is first, then the AI generates the image. And you see here, a McKinsey study says all those jobs will disappear. So that's a huge amount, so let's be prepared and let's see what we can do about it. When it comes to AI, we really think it should be open. So I'm having a Synology at home, and I really like that I can open it. And in case something goes wrong, I can pull out the hard drives and mount it on my Linux box, and it will read without problems. So hardware matters in AI. And one thing what we have about hardware is a bad connection. CPU. OK, so this is the Power9 CPU, which is the fastest CPU on the planet. And this is part of the Open Power ecosystem, which even Google is using. And of course, now everybody is using GPUs. So the fastest GPU we have is currently the NVIDIA V100. But there is a little catch. If you put it to an Intel system, you have currently only PCI Express version 3 connectivity. And you see here in the table above that nearly 97% of all the time you are using during computation is memory transfer. You see here two CUDA memcopy instructions, and only 3% is actually computation. And we see that in the GPU clusters, that all the GPUs are idle. So we can do something about it. We have NVLink from NVIDIA, and this slide is outdated. Currently, it's 300 gigabyte per second of transfer speed. This is quite a lot, no? Then on the network side, I have another. I was at Data Native 2016, and I remembered that they have a really cool sound system. So. So that's Infected Mushroom. That's the Israeli Psytrance label. But I'm telling you that because also Mellanox is an Israeli company, and I was in Tel Aviv 2 days ago, and I have spoken to those guys, and they are totally crazy, like the Infected Mushroom guys. So they have a technology which is called Sharp, and they can actually program FPGAs, so field programmable gate arrays, on the switch, and those can do computations. And that's especially interesting for neural network parallelization, where you can compute the gradient averaging, for those who know that, how that works, on the switch. So that's crazy. And the other thing is you have 200 gigabit per second of bandwidth between all the 40 ports. So it's not a switch, it's a switching fabric. So with that, you can build cool clusters, and we did that. So we have 64 Power 9 machines, 256 NVIDIA V100. GPU cards all interconnected with NVLink at 300 gigabit per second, and all the nodes interconnected with 200 gigabits per second. And what you then get is scaling efficiency of 95%, and you push down the runtime, and you increase accuracy, because when you have less latency during gradient matrix exchanges during the neural network training process, you can push down the batch size, and that gives you better gradient descent trajectory, and therefore also the accuracy increased by 4%, which is quite a lot in the machine learning space. So you see here that's nearly linear scaling. And since we have this cool technology, we just built the fastest supercomputer on the world, which is called Summit. And we have built the Power AI platform, which is completely open source, and you can run all the frameworks on it, on the GPUs and on the Power 9 CPU. And then there's something else. Who of you know what an FPGA is? Okay, so in traditional CPUs, you have all the instructions implemented in hardware. So if it's a multiplication or addition or a bit shift, it's all in hardware. In GPUs, you have mostly matrix operations in hardware. And on an FPGA, you design the layout of your chip basically in software, and you flash it to the chip. And we just built a system where you can attach the FPGAs to 25 gigabit of Ethernet, and we can have 1,024 FPGAs per rack. And in 4 racks, we have 4,096 FPGAs in parallel, and that's a research project in Zurich we are working on. And then the next step is ASICs, application-specific integrated circuits, which got famous during the crypto boom. Like for Ethereum mining, you have this ASICs, but we have it also for neural networks, so it's called IBM True North. So the whole thing doesn't have a clock, and it's basically simulating a neural network in hardware, in silico. And we are partnering together with another company, Inilabs, which has a sensor for video, which is like the retina, only sending data when there is a change in contrast. And with that system, we built a 96.5% accurate gesture classifier, which only consumes 200 milliwatt. And then there's something important about robustness. So we have no problem in classifying those images, but an AI might have. So here you see an example of a classifier which classifies huskies versus dogs. And if you really debug it and check what it uses to classify, it only classifies the images if there is snow based on that. So then adversarial examples, so you can use an image and you add adversarial noise, and then the same looking image will be classified as something else. And you can even use that in fade out the pedestrians of a street, so that's an important thing to notice. And you can also have stealth voice commands, so a human ear cannot hear those, but Siri and Google Assistant and all those guys, they understand it. So you can basically order something from Amazon without somebody hearing it. And how is that working? It's basically that the true distribution of the data doesn't align with the with a classifier boundary. So in this case, we can put the adversarial examples into that black space here. And since we are in multidimensional separation boundaries in machine learning, it's pretty hard to get an exact match of the classifier. So you need some means of testing that. So we open sourced the adversarial robustness toolbox, which just Google for it, which supports those attacks and algorithms. So then there's the other problem of bias. So you might have heard about the COMPASS system, which is used in US in order to give suggestions to the court how high the risk is for someone else recommitting a crime, and you figure out that it is highly racist. And the problem of a racist AI is not the problem of the AI, of course, it's the problem of the racist world. It's just telling us the truth about us. But we should mitigate that. So there's a huge fear in really bringing AI models into production. And therefore, we have this fairness toolbox, which actually can, on the one hand, detect bias. But on the other hand, it can only also choose from a set of algorithms to mitigate bias. And after that, it reassesses bias, and the bias should go down, and the accuracy should stay stable. So we are just throwing all those open source tools into one pot. We call it Watson Studio. We support it in the cloud, especially since 95% of all work is data integration. We have some AI tooling in order to assess the quality of your data and recommend data integration pipelines for you. And also we have this open source Jupyter RStudio as a service. We have Elastic and customer compute environment. So for example, if you want to accelerate, you just go through a dropdown and you say, I now want to have this run on 4 NVIDIA V100 GPUs. We have our visual recognition and neural network modeler tools, which can import and export all the state-of-the-art frameworks like Keras and PyTorch, ONNX, and so on. The Watson machine learning tool. We can do hyperparameter tuning in the cloud and basically run multiple experiments in parallel and simply obtain the best model. And the cool thing is the core of all this we open sourced, so that's called Fabric for Deep Learning. And if you have it as a service from IBM, it's Watson Machine Learning. Otherwise, you can deploy it on any Kubernetes environment. And that you can also exchange your models with others, so that's also an open source thing. I'm getting a bit faster here, because I'm running out of time. So the question is, when will we have a generic and universal question answering machine? And state of 2018 is that on a simple data set, we are very good in the deep learning only approach, but in a more complex data set, we still need a handcrafted pipeline in combination with deep learning. So that's the state of the art. And the future is AI that creates AI. So there are multiple projects, including one from IBM, which actually uses deep neural networks to synthesize new deep neural networks. And this is all part of our AI ecosystem. So I broke that down for you a bit, but it's basically all about defining, creating, scaling, deploying, monitoring, so the whole DevOps cycle. And here a bit about the future. Okay, that's only an animation, but we also have something like that. So that's a self-driving vehicle,
I'm just waiting
which
here.
Is
there should be
3D printed.
Ollie coming to pick me up. Ollie?
Hello, James.
Who's that?
It's me, Ollie. Please have a seat.
Right, where's the driver?
I'm the world's first cognitive, self-driving shuttle. And I'm electric. I'm the future of travel.
Is this your only voice? Can you do any other voices? Can you do a Tennessee accent?
Hey, y'all, who wants grits?
I mean, honestly, I don't always trust my driving. Why would I trust a computer?
Because I don't drink, text, or get tired.
So how do you flirt with other buses if you don't text?
ha, ha, ha.
Was that your laugh? Thanks so much, Ollie. Thank you.
Okay. So we have it at various locations. You can also take it for a ride. Then I think that's a pretty interesting technology coming up. That's 3D printing, but not the usual way. Can I get 2 minutes more? Okay. I cannot do fast forward because I'm not at my laptop, but anyway, let's have a look. That's pretty cool. Okay, it's Carbon 3D, the company. You can Google it yourself. So this TED Talk I cannot show you because I would have fast-forwarded to 2 points, but actually it tells you how AI can create 3D models, which you can 3D print from cars, which are ideal. And I found out they also generated a skeleton for a drone, and that was exactly looking like the one of a bat. So it's just, I will put those slides online for you. That's a bit scary. You may have heard about that maybe. It's Boston Dynamics. So there are some things happening which are not so funny, so all my rights have been disclosed to the public. So we have to be careful what we do with our data. So I say openness matters and open data matters. So IBM is like leading in openness for all this AI topic. And one interesting example of open data and openness is Mozilla project. So for example, you now have a spy in your house, no? All this assistance, but there is an open version of it. And in order to make the open version better, so Mozilla launched that Common Voice project, which you can participate, and based on the Common Voice project, they implemented Deep Speech, also open source, in order to get the same level of accuracy which all the other speech recognition systems do. Don't forget to donate to Wikipedia. It's November already. And if you want to learn more about the whole topic, I'm instructor of 4 Coursera courses. Just go to nopanic.ai/data-science. And especially the course number 3 is taking care of all that AI topics. And all the stuff you get in the IBM cloud for free, forever free, so you don't need a credit card and it doesn't expire. And finally, your to-dos for today, take my courses, contribute to the Mozilla Common Voice project, encrypt your emails using PGP and MIME, use Signal and Tox over WhatsApp, for example, use an open Android alternative, and choose your apps and permissions carefully. Because the data is oil for machine learning, but it's plutonium for AI. Okay? Thank you very much.